in London in 1975, there was a sense of the whole city winding down, no investment, no hope, just a city in decay and a city collapsing.
It's like a wasteland with just nothing. Well, we had energy, we wanted to go somewhere, we wanted to do something. There was nothing to do, nowhere to go. So we just kind of circle around, walking underneath those sort of housing developments and projects and concrete soulless places where there's nothing. Sort of hopelessness. Well, we had hope in a sea of hopelessness.
It was a very, very squalid period, massive unemployment, absolutely no hope, class warfare rampant, quite literally no future. I wrote my own future. I had to. It was the only way out. I meant that for us. We had to perform this stuff, because that's what it had become by then. Just stuff, just rock and roll, just trundling out night after night. It had lost its point. It was too much like a Rolling Stones on tour affair. Too big. And indeed, when things get that way, then you should stop. It's the easiest thing in the world to just stop. If you don't want to be a pop star, just stop being one.
The Sex Pistols came along, made an incredible amount of chaos, and then broke up. You know, and left this, you know, left everyone else to clean up their mess, you know. I mean, the Ramones had to go out there and keep playing.
We kind of felt us and the Sex Pistols would become almost like the Beatles and the Stones of the 60s, you know what I mean? Like we were the new revolution, let's say, you know. But America wouldn't have it that way.
And no record company wanted to touch anybody after the Sex Pistols who was in a punk band.
I liked the Sex Pistols, but they were just there for a second. They were gone really fast, and by the time the Sex Pistols had come and gone, there were all these great LA bands playing.
Punk in the narrow sense of the word, where you had to play a certain way, sound a certain way on record, look a certain way, probably worked in England because England was A, much more fashion conscious, and B, poor. That kind of punk, that kind of anger, certainly doesn't work in a 70s America where, you know, kids have plenty of toys to play with. So music of rebellion or music that challenges establishment had to take a different form in America.
Basically, the 200 people that made up the original punk rock scene of LA were people that didn't fit in. And it wasn't just artists. It was working class people that were bohemian. The time that we began X, it was a frightening time because people didn't want to know about what we were talking about.
What we wrote about was how estranged we were, and we wrote a lot about being poor and seeing a lot of wealthy people, because it was still the Hollywood scene. There were still movie stars and rock stars and producers and people getting big deals. There was still Fleetwood Mac, and we were so different from that.
It was just like Los Angeles in 66, 67. The same kind of street club activity was happening all over again in 78, 79, 80, and I was just absolutely hooked. I was everywhere that you could possibly go. And I told everybody, I said, you know, none of you people know this, but this is exactly what we did, you know, 15 years ago, the psychedelic generation, and you guys are now totally insane punk rockers.
Sex wants every hour.
X was one of the most exciting bands I'd ever come across, and I couldn't believe that they were actually poetic. Lyrics had that kind of street beatnik impact. Took me back to 58, 60, 62 when the Beats were at their height, and I thought, man, this is the same kind of stuff.
LA bus doors open. Kicking both doors open. Girl inside.
Everything went along just great until, at some point, the audiences went from being relatively intelligent and understanding, interesting people to kind of scary young kids who liked to spit at the bands a lot, who wielded chains and beat up people who had long hair. And it became a kind of a war between what was and this kind of new hardcore scene.
She wasn't what you call a big, really.
Along with the Misfits, there were some people that were genuinely psychotic, and they were there to inflict pain and not to be part of the core audience. A song like Johnny Hit and Run Pauline, we won't play anymore because the audience, I've seen too many 19 and 20 year old boy men going like this, Johnny Hit and Run Pauline, and don't understand that it's an anti-rape song. And they're like into it for the wrong reason, so we don't play that anymore.
Society stinks.
But this hardcore scene was particularly scary and violent, and it was what gave punk a bad name. We kept begging them to stop spitting at us. We kept saying, no, you don't understand. See, the media wants to make this into a cartoon, and they say that in England, bands get spit at by the audience.
The spitting was just utter nonsense, journalistic fabrication. Unfortunately, the newer crowds that came into it didn't understand that.
Spitting on your heroes has been popular, you know, ever since in different ways. And maybe that's okay, and maybe that was the part of punk was a thing about the anti-hero, really.
Yeah, I mean, a healthy disrespect for authority is what, you know, supposedly runs through the whole history of rock and roll.
That's their job. Mine's to make the music, theirs is to sell it. And it never said in my contract that I had to make the same record over and over again.
The burden of pity.
It's harder for people to change the rules, in rock and roll because it's such a very, very limited form musically that it comes down to somebody's imagination, you know, what they have in their heart.
As soon as the people got hold of the idea that, all right, it's punk, we get it, we got it, and then when we started to play other things, they didn't like it because people don't like change.
When you step into that public arena. On one hand, it's maybe where some of the greatest possibilities are located. At the same time, it's the most dangerous place because it's where you're most easily subverted.
To reach a wider audience, you have to give something up. I mean, people still hate us in England for making it in America. I'm glad we did. You know, somebody had to break out and prove that this thing was a global thing. It wasn't just a neighborhood thing. When you're struggling to get somewhere, the struggle can really hold you together. not a blinding rush for fame. You're expressing a soul, and you've got to do it in the right way. What killed us was success. For some reason, we weren't prepared. We'd spend like 5 years getting there. Perhaps after 5 years, we'd said our piece, if you like. A lot of the great groups didn't exist for very long.
To lump artists like the Sex Pistols, the Clash, and Elvis Costello under the banner of punk is really an indication of how categories fail. And I suppose everybody wanted one band to do it, like it happened with the Beatles. And it turned out not to be one band, but a lot of bands, a lot of journalists, a lot of young record people who went into the record companies and changed them.
I remember when Seymour Stein sold Sire Records to Warner Brothers, Bugs Bunny being the Warner Brothers character, he was in all these advertisements in a black leather jacket, and said, "Don't call it punk, call it new wave." So new wave was really a term for people, college kids, you know. I remember at the time everyone said, "I don't like the Ramones, but I like the Talking Heads." You know, it was safe. New wave was safe.
Punk rock wasn't necessarily very musical or melodic, and I think new wave is when things, you know, a few jangly guitars and melodies, I guess. I don't know. Love walks in the room.
We thought we were a punk band for about a minute. Very early on, just after we'd figured out our bar chords, realized that we wanted to say more than fuck off, even though there was some pretty cool ways of saying fuck off around at the time.
New wave was watered down. That was the complete corruption of everything. So everybody tried to be nice all over again. And don't be nice, it's the kiss of death.
We were trying to change something. The music industry, the way we live, you know, to be accepted any way we want to, you know. Can't you see you belong to me? I'm a poor aches, but every step you take, every move you make, every vow you break, every smile.
I've always believed that to be esoteric or underground music of one generation becomes the pop music of the next generation. You know, there's jazz purists whose job is to keep it pure and the same. Rock and roll is the opposite. Rock and roll started as a bastard, as a hybrid. It was never pure to begin with.
When the punk rock group started, it was kind of an us and them kind of thing. The establishment was them and then there was us. But I think they had to grow up very rapidly because some of them became successful, got deals, and realized that really they had to work with the system to get anywhere. Some handled this, some left totally devastated. You know, they got money and consequently didn't get that creative because they weren't hungry anymore or they could buy more drugs and they ended up dead. And you know, only the people that had any real content and staying power managed to get over that hurdle.
Most of the musicians I know, you know, their work is, it's at the core of their identity. It's what they, a good deal of what they created their identity from. You know, it's fundamental to you. You feel like it is you, you know. And so when you step into that the mass cultural arena, like I said, there's a real element of you're on dangerous ground, you know, at the same time, I always thought that that was where you found out what you could do.
American corporations took 10 or 15 years to recover from the shock of the Sex Pistols and the fluke of actually managing to sell the Clash to the general public, to really take a step back and find Nirvana and a few other bands. Load up our guns, bring your friends, it's fun to lose and to pretend. She's overboard, self-assured.
Punk came up, you know what it was, in England. That was the last time anything really important happened in England or came from England to affect anybody. You know what happened is that punk said, we're fed up with Pink Floyd, Jethro Tull, Led Zeppelin, the sort of skeleton of the Beatles, let's have some music from the street. And what's happened in America in 1991, 90, is that you finally got your own punk.
But I know that that type of success is very, very, is stressful on you, you know? It's very stressful. And because you're constantly, you feel yourself, you think you feel yourself slipping away in some fashion. You know, maybe you're not, maybe you are, you know?
Home to me, as many things have in my maturity, the fact that this is a very dangerous business. It's a very dangerous for the practitioners.
It's like a fire, and it burns and it burns and it burns and it burns. And that sounds like a sort of kind of a romantic fire idea until you realize that what's keeping the fire alight is bodies.
I think rock and roll exists to deliver this truth that needs to be constantly delivered. Rock, hip hop, whatever you call it. It reminds us, like this unspoken message, is that it is fun to be alive. It's a hell of a lot better than being dead.
I think that my whole life was saved and opened up and made into a real life by my favorite singers, yeah. By Johnny Cash, Muddy Waters, the Rolling Stones, the Beatles. I'm gonna forget so many people. John Lee Hooker, I'll forget a lot of people, but yes, by the stuff that went before.
Rock and roll's always thrived on people not necessarily willfully throwing things into the mix, but sort of stumbling on things, crossing over. Short circuits and misconnections, and the people who have the tight, you know, spandex pants on and their hair just so and the guitar at the right angle, you know, aren't it at all, you know, the cigarette coming from the lip like this, because it's a facsimile of something that was previously rock and roll doesn't make it rock and roll forever. It's somebody in a bedroom somewhere doing something you haven't heard yet, with any luck.
So how did the audience react when the Stooges first started playing? First of all, what did you look like?
I appeared in an aluminum afro wig I made myself out of strips of heavy-duty aluminum, which I curled. No eyebrows, had a woman's maternity smock, totally white face. I was playing a Hawaiian guitar, standing up. Another fella
who operated a Waring blender. There was another guy whose job it was to just tip over the top of an amp at certain times with the reverb turned on 10. It just sounded like... I also played vacuum cleaner. That's why I go for that rock and roll music. And people found it really interesting. It's got a backbeat, you can't lose it. Any old time you use it. It's gotta be rock and roll music. If you wanna dance with me. If you wanna dance with me. Don't care to hear them play a tango. I'm in the mood to dig a mambo. It's way too early for the congo. So keep rocking that piano, so I can hear some of that rock and roll music. Any old way you choose it, it's got a backbeat, you can't lose it. Any old time you use it, it's gotta be rock and roll music. If you wanna dance with me, if you